hard, I feel, to match the performance of Bjarte Boxnes and the Mary Williams here, because I think you were brilliant. But I would try to give my side of the story, so to speak. It might be a bit similar message from you as well. I would like to start to show you a movie, which I think shows agile leadership in a very good manner.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. So it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out, you create ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out. They won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
Leadership is over-glorified. Do you agree? Maybe so. So let's see. Get back to my presentation. Just listen to.
No way, by the way.
That's what we do in the MT every Monday, isn't it?
So I'm going to talk to you today about engagement, about agile HR, and about agile leadership. I used to say that I'm a hybrid, pronounce it that way, I think, between IT, HR, and leadership. Because I have a BA from the Economic School of Gothenburg. I have a master in IT management, and I worked mainly in IT with IT systems for HR. So I think I have a little of everything. And I run a company with these people. This is my staff and my employees. And we are 8 consultants in Sweden, Gothenburg and Stockholm. And we work with agile HR and agile leadership for large Swedish corporations with an international business. How many here are working with HR? Anybody? Yes, some of you? how many are working with IT? Everybody, obviously. Yeah. And who, how many of you have people that you manage? Okay, quite a bunch also. Great. How many have previous experience with agile HR or agile leadership? Just a few. Yeah. Because what we see now is really that this area, agile HR and agile leadership, is growing very rapidly from the IT movement, so to speak. When I started to work with agile, it was within IT, a small agile team. And I quickly saw that these values that you have within the agile team are so good, they can easily be used in any part of the company or any part of the business. So this guy, what's his name? Do you know?
David,
yes, it's Charles Darwin. And he was famous for a quote, said something like this, survival of the fittest, right? But does it really mean survival of the strongest?
No.
No, it doesn't. The fittest, in his opinion, was the species who are who have the possibility to adapt to changing circumstances and the changing environment. These are the species that survive and thrive and go on. And the same goes for our organizations, of course. The businesses who can adapt to changing circumstances, they will continue to live. And this is what Bjarte talked a great deal about this morning as well. We need to be much more flexible in the future. The state of the global workforce. I don't know if you have seen this report. It's from Gallup. It was conducted in November 2013. And what they did here was that they asked the same 12 questions to 230,000 employees in 142 countries all over the world. These questions were asked, and you can see yourself. It's about, do you have purpose in work? Do you have a best friend at work, and so on. And they wanted to determine the level of engagement in corporations worldwide. And here is the result. Only 13% on average are engaged, what they call engaged. We will soon look at what does it mean to be engaged. 63% are indifferent. And 24% are actively disengaged. So these are, I think, alarming figures. Why are people not enjoying their works, their workplaces? So we're going to have a closer look at these three categories. The engaged, they are the people who really enjoy work. They work with passion and drive, and they light up their workplaces, right? And they drive, and they love their work, really. And you can see the figures here. If you, we look at, for example, Sweden. Well, 16% in Sweden. Do you have in Great Britain, that's slightly higher? 70% of the workforce are engaged in Great Britain. So this is very different throughout the world, but the, among the highest figures in Europe are in Denmark, actually, with 21% engaged employees. And the least engaged are the French and the Dutch at the bottom. We could speculate on why. Quite interesting. This report is very interesting to read, actually. And this is the large passive group. They are not engaged. Neither disengaged, they're just in the middle. You know, this is the big crowd. They are mostly waiting for lunch, really. But they are there, they're smiling occasionally. And sometimes they do a good job. 80% in the Netherlands. And I mean, Jürgen Appelo, who did this leadership management trio, maybe you know him or have heard of him. He's from the Netherlands, and you can see why. We need to engage people in the Netherlands. But also, yeah, Great Britain is so not so bad. No? I don't know.
It's the best.
Yeah. The third group, these are the actively disengaged people in our workplaces, and honestly, we would be better off if we didn't have them in our workplaces. Honestly, we should get rid of them as soon as possible, because they are really undermining the work that other people are doing. And this unengagement in the world cost Germany at least 151 billion each year, and Great Britain is paying 83 billion for the disengagement in companies. So you can easily see, if we could increase engagement, that would be maybe the most important investment to make, to invest in our people and to try to create engagement. But yeah, so we're going to discuss that. How do we then go about doing it? The best place to work in Sweden is a company called King. I don't know if you know a little game called Candy Crush Saga. Do you know this game? It comes from this Swedish company King, which also happens to be the best place to work, chosen last year. And of course they're happy. They work with agile methods, right? So you can see the boards and everything, everybody's smiling, diversity in the team and so on. Of course there are other companies as well, like Statoil and other big companies who do this as well. So organizations in the future will look very different than they do today. Methods and leadership models that we have in most organizations today were actually invented over 100 years ago, and we still use them. And you know what? They don't work anymore. So we need to change. This is what work life could look like in the, maybe 80 years ago, I would think. People were doing pretty much the same thing. We were using their bodies, but not their minds. Hierarchies ruled, and leadership looked like this. Big leaders appointed little leaders, power was a function of position. Senior executives set strategy, of course, everyone reported to a boss. Tasks were assigned to you. Only managers gave rewards, of course. Compensation correlated with rank, you all recognize this. Promotion was a measure of achievement, and autonomy was, of course, not very common. And this picture is still quite common in many companies today, right? And especially, I mean, in Sweden, in the Nordic countries, we have come quite a long way when it comes to erasing this kind of management, if you want. But I see signs here in the UK that you still are a bit, according to this philosophy, you're working a bit different than we do. And this is another picture from a Ford factory. People were indeed a part of a machinery on this time. They were not thinking creatures. And scientific management, also called Taylorism, was the kind of management methods that they were using in these days. They analyzed workflows, they optimized workflows, and they thought that somebody in the top has the brain capacity to think and to decide how shall people be working, how shall they perform their work tasks. Because obviously they can't do it, they are just performing the work, they are just a body for us. And about theory X, which you already know what it is, because Gat explained it to us, people are lazy. People don't do anything unless you have a carrot or a stick, opposed to theory Y, where you have a belief that people are self-motivated and want to work and can find their inner drive and passion. So it's just to choose, which one are you? Which kind of leader are you? Do you believe in theory X or theory Y? Work life today, of course, looks very different from this time. Innovation is extremely important to us. The technological pace is very, very fast. So there are different challenges in every organization today. So that's why we also need, of course, to change the leadership. We cannot go on leading with this old methodology that was invented in the 18th century. So really, this is what we want, right? What is this? This is an engaged worker. This guy, or girl for that matter, is coming to work on Monday morning saying, new week, new possibilities, yes, I'm here again. Right? So, work is so important for us. We work at least 8 hours a day. Many of us work much more. So we spend a tremendous amount of our life in our workplaces. That's why we really have to make it as good as possible. And just as Mary said, we bring work back home with us as well. If we had a shitty day at work, you can be sure that you bring that shit back with you home. And it will affect your wife, it will affect your children, it will affect your marriage, your sex life even, you name it. People who are engaged at work have actually a better sex life. And their kids do better in school. So, have I convinced you? Good. We can copy everything. We can copy raw material, we can copy production processes, we can copy marketing campaigns, everything can be copied of our competitors. But our employees and their unique engagement and their unique competences cannot be copied. They are unique, and we need to treat them that way. And if we do that, there are some consequences that are not so bad either for us, right? Engaged employees create, of course, happier customers because they are served by people who feel good and are happy. And happier customers are more loyal and buy more. And we all know what that means in the end. And now I don't want to stop here because nobody wants to work for a company anymore whose highest goal is to create a bunch of money for the people who own the place, right? We want a purpose, we want a higher goal, we want a vision to buy into. That's why we need to put something here. What can we do with this money once we make it? What can we achieve? What higher goals can we achieve? And especially the young workforce today, they don't work for a company who says, yeah, our highest goal is to make money. And then if the managers here are smart, they will put some money back in here and invest in more things that will engage employees. Then you get those good circles. So we're coming there, how to engage. Engagement will create performance, right? And performance will create an increased result. Do you agree? Great, good. That's the first step. Piece of cake. Or? Okay, so how will we engage? That's of course the big question. So I have compiled a few things that I have seen, that I have read a lot of management books, I've read a lot of literature, and I have seen for myself in my team and in my customers and clients' teams, what is it that really makes people engaged? And how do we define engagement? Because that's also an important topic. Some people think that, yeah, an engaged employee, that's just this kind of soft stuff, happy employees, why do we need that? But that's not how we define it. We define it like this. Let's say we have organizational contribution here on this, and we have employee satisfaction here, and here is our engaged employee, and the direction we want them to move in is from here to here. It's all relative, right? You're somewhere, but we want you to move up towards this corner here. So if you're here, how do you feel now? Hey, you're probably very happy. You're probably having a good time with your colleagues, maybe surfing the internet a lot and having discussions all days that don't concern work or your goals. but you feel good.
What about here? Here, up here is what we call the crash and burners, the people who work very, very much, but they don't feel very good, right? They produce a lot of results. What we want is both. We want people to feel good, and we want them to produce results. That's when we get the engaged employee. And now we're talking, because now it becomes interesting for top management to invest. Oh, can we increase productivity? Can we increase the return on investment? Yeah, then top management will listen. So you saw these values, of course, are all what I call agile values. It's things that you need to work with in an agile team, except for the tools that you work. You work with Scrum, you work with retrospectives, we work with daily stand-ups, and so on. And these are all tools or methods that we use, but without this, it's nothing. They don't work. So the tools and the methods will not work without the culture, without the right values, and the right behaviors in the organization.
Line of sight.
Yeah, I will actually come to that. Okay. I will explain the concept line of sight in a minute. So the trends for future employees are quite, yeah, I found this picture yesterday. I thought it was quite good. It's to work anytime, work anywhere, use any device, bring your own device. You all know this kind of expressions coming. Create your own ladder. It's flexibility, it's customized work, it's information sharing and transparency. It's all about fulfilling your own needs, in a way. And you will get these slides afterwards as well. So this question is probably the most important question that you can answer when your employees come to you and ask. And maybe they don't come and ask. Even then, it's as important. I mean, kids, they ask why all the time. They ask, why is the sky blue? Why is your name Pia-Maria? Why is the snot from the nose green? Because they want to know, they're curious. But when we start working and when we get into this corporate thinking, then we lose the sense of why. We don't know anymore why we do what we do, unless we make it extremely clear for all our employees. So that's the most important question to answer. If you at least know why, then you have a much better chance of choosing the right things to do every day. And there is very little passion to reach any goals if you don't know why. It all starts with a dream. He said it. Back on the 50s, he said, I have a dream, he said. He didn't say, I have a 5-year plan. Because
some
people don't buy into 5-year plans.
Some people did say, I have a 5-year plan.
Did they?
Yeah.
With him?
No. I think it was Brezhnev in the 1960s.
Yeah.
Maybe. And you know what happened there?
Yeah, well, I'm not sure, but I know that people were doing things that they would normally not do because of this dream. They were self-organizing. And he didn't have to have a plan. I mean, people were running, doing all kinds of boring tasks just because they shared the same dream. So this is, of course, the best way to make people run in some direction. So here we have line of sight. So I will try to answer your question about line of sight. We have the dream in the top, okay, that's the most important thing that drives us. You need to have a dream. Company needs to have a larger goal, a vision. And the normal way is to break it down, or you do it bottom up, right? My tip here is to really break it down to some level, because up here, if you just have the dream, it's really difficult to know exactly what to do. If you break it down a little bit into here somewhere, and then you let the team look at these goals up here and say, okay, we can do this. So you get this kind of bottom-up, top-down, meet-in-the-middle performance thing.
And of course, you have to have the transparency in this breakdown very clear. Because where is business execution happening in this figure? Is it here? No? Is it here? Here. This is where business execution is happening. This is where we execute the business. Here, what every employee is doing every day sums up to the fulfillment of the dream in the end. And if we have this transparency, then it becomes very clear what we can do and what we should do to reach company goals, right? And this is lacking in most of our large corporations today, the clarity of goals, vision and mission, and so on. The ordinary worker, they don't know this. If you go out and ask some new manager, or old manager for that matter, in Volvo Cars in Sweden, what are your goals? Oh, I wouldn't know. They don't know. So this is the importance of perspective then. These are two stone cutters. This one is cutting stone every day, all day. This guy, he's not cutting stone, he's building a cathedral. He knows that in 5 years' time, or when he has grandchildren and the cathedral is standing there, he will be able to say to them, look, I built this cathedral. I worked here. It's fantastic. But this guy is only miserable. So it can make all the difference in the world if you have a perspective and how you see where you're going. Having fun at work, yeah? That's the question. That's of course very important. We need to have fun at work. And if the president of the United States can have fun at work, I think we can have a bit of fun also in our organization. But important to remember here is that the leader set the standard. So if the leader is not having fun, nobody will have fun. You need to start having fun if you're a leader. And control. This is the bad picture of control, we used to call it. And of course, control is the biggest obstacle for performance and for passion and everything that leads towards our vision. And it's also the biggest obstacle to make people take responsibility. Because the more you control, the more you instruct, and the more you reward, the more need you create for instruction, control, and reward. And people stop taking responsibility, and when they don't reach their goals, they blame their managers. Transparency will actually take care of some of the control. And Bjarte stole this one from me, or I stole it from him, I don't know. But he told you about the travel claims in that company, that if you make them visible, control will take care of itself. It's a good example of that. Focus. Focus is really about being able to prioritize what you do every day. You can't have eight simultaneous goals that you're running towards and believe that you are going to deliver those goals with a good quality, because you will not. It's impossible. You should have one or two goals at the most. But most companies, when they work with performance management, they say, yeah, 6 to 8 goals is way too much. You have to be able to focus on one thing, deliver that, and then focus on the next thing. Then you will deliver with quality. So this driver, what do you think the focus for this driver is? To win the race, right? He wants to win the race. That's his top focus. But he needs to focus on many other things as well, like having gas in the car, having a good car, having a good team serving the car, being in good health, you know, mentally, physically, and so on, to be able to drive very fast. But the focus goal is to win the race. It's one goal. And then he's doing a lot of things to reach that goal. Autonomy and trust. Also extremely important values when you work with Agile. And you can't have one without the other. That's why I put them together. You can't have autonomy without trust. And autonomy is all about being able to work wherever you want, whenever you want, however you want, within your capacity, within your competence. Of course, if you have a new employee, you need to be more detailed and coach much more. But if you have a mature employee, give them the goal and let them run, wherever they are. And it's extremely encouraging for an employee to know that my manager trusts me to do my work and to deliver the results wherever I am, even if I don't show up at work. So they are intimately intertwined, these two values. So let's have a look at HR. This is a quote from one of our customers, actually. We have a lot of large HR projects in Sweden right now. One HR in Volvo, in SKF, in ICA, in IKEA, in all these large corporate businesses, they do process mapping for HR. And of course, this is not always a good thing. I mean, if you work, for example, with performance management, it's really impossible to perform according to a process because it's driven by passion and motivation. Processes are quite good when it comes to, you know, hygienic HR processes like paying salaries or benefits or this kind of processes. It's okay. You can work with Lean, for example, for that. So HR's role is changing. In the past, it's been a lot about implementing controls, implementing standards, writing policies, driving alignment and execution. But in the future, HR will have a totally different role. HR will need to support instead adaptability, innovation, speed, and work much more with the strategic goals and supporting the business to be able to deliver. This will be HR's role, coaching the managers instead of telling them what to do and not to do. So this is a huge change in the area of HR, and HR is a terrible word in the first place. So this is a summary of how does then HR change when we go from traditional HR to agile HR. Well, as you can see, it goes from this episodic reactive and one-size-fits-all processes, standardized processes, to much more ongoing, proactive, on a needs basis way of working. We need to support the manager when they need the support. From machine to network, from individual to team, from management to employeeship, from this theory X to theory Y. From extrinsic motivation to intrinsic motivation. This is the kind of motivation you get when you say, if you do this, you get that. And that's what we typically do with bonuses. This doesn't work. This works for a while and a bit. But if you remove the bonus, the effect will be the opposite. People will be demotivated if you remove the bonus. Feedback should increase. That might be the most important thing we can do as manager, is to give feedback. And not just manager to employee, but also employee to manager, or between employees, or all the time. Good and constructive feedback. In its simplest form, an SMS that you send, it takes half a minute, it can make a person's week. You can increase engagement with one SMS. Tremendously. And so we have the team in the middle here. This is a picture showing talent management, integrity talent management, and people management, as we say. talent management is the HR view, people management is the management view, but it's exactly the same processes, and it's exactly the same things that these two areas are there to support. We have the team in the middle, that's the center of the universe. The team needs to reach goals. They have a vision, they are supposed to do something that we can hopefully sell in the end. For that, they need competence, and they can then recruit competence from outside or internally, or they can, of course, develop the people that they already have to gain competence. There are two ways to gain competence to the team, to make sure that they have the competence to deliver on goals. Learning could look very different, as you know. Could be being a mentor, getting a coach, reading a book. It's only fantasy that sets the limits here. And they want to be fairly rewarded. So this is the same things, regardless if you work with traditional HR management or agile HR management. But you can do it in so many different ways, right? So we're going to look at how does that these processes change when we do them or see them from an agile perspective instead of seeing them from a traditional perspective. So I want to start with leadership or management. So this is the team, this is the universe, right? All things that HR managers do are aimed to support the team to be able to perform better. That's what they are there for. Eliminating obstacles, of course, giving them the tools and the methods they need. Communicate feedback. Making sure there are no problems within the team, between team members and so on, and giving purpose and vision. So when it comes to leadership, it should be delegated as much as possible to the team, as mature as the team is. There is a game that I wanted to play with you today. It's called delegation poker. Have anyone played that? Yeah, one person, two. Yeah, it's from Management 3.0. It's a great game because it clarifies on what level can different persons in the organization make decisions. And we decide that together with the delegation poker cards. So I will send you a link to that. Anyway, it's about clarifying who can take what decisions on what level, right? So the goal is always to give more responsibility to the team, but if the team is not mature, then you cannot give more responsibility. So you need to feel that as a manager. How much responsibility can they take now? How mature are they? And the more responsibility you give, the more high performing the team will be. So really, the goal for the leader is to eliminate yourself, right? You can focus on other things, strategic partnerships or whatever, sales or something else. What do managers believe matters for employees? Yeah, they believe that these black things in this black area matters. They think it matters that they get a bonus, that they have clear rules, that they need supervision, that they have performance metrics. But it's really not what matters at all for people. What matters really is recognition, responsibility, autonomy, mastery, and all of these damn pink values are in here. Autonomy, mastery, purpose are in here as well. Belonging and trust, and to learn new things, develop yourself and grow is highest actually. The only thing that is shared here is a decent salary. You want to have a decent salary. Everybody wants a decent salary. Not too high, not too low. About what I think I'm worth. That's where we all agree. And I cannot stop myself from going into this metaphor again. Though I know many people have done it already. It's about planting the seed, but you can't really make it grow. you can make sure that the seed gets water, gets sunshine, gets good soil. You can remove the weeds around, but you can't make the seed grow, how much you try. I mean, you just can hope that it will grow if you give the right conditions. So this is leadership.
What do you do when the seed doesn't grow?
What do we do? We try to help.
Yeah.
I think Mary could answer that one better than me.
find them somewhere else where they will germinate.
Right.
Good answer. I'm assuming you've done everything.
Yeah, I mean, you try again, and if nothing works,
and you're an engineer, fix a problem, engineer it out.
But I mean, there is always a reason why the seed doesn't grow. It could be that the person is sick, has alcohol problems, has going through a divorce, or anything, could be anything. So the first thing you need to find out is why. That's the first thing, and that's what many managers never do. They let people sit in the corner and not perform and not deliver because they don't dare to take that conversation with people. It doesn't feel good. Yes. So this is a picture of the agile leadership. How long, you may wonder. How long did you say?
Less than five. Finish at 1:45.
Well, of course, the juicy inside here with a lot of the taste. And this is why we buy the burrito, right? It's not for the bread around, which is then the leadership, of course. It should be a thin layer, just enough to keep the tasty filling in place. So bread is the leadership. The juicy filling is our employees. That's why we buy the burrito, because we want the taste. Agile leadership. Performance management. I made an agile performance management process for Volvo cars. And it looked like this. Very simple. You set goals, very few, one or two, not more. You plan for development connected to goals. You link daily activities to the goals. And you follow up and give feedback and reward, and you learn afterwards. So you see what it is? During this process, you need to lead and coach employees towards the goals. That's HR's and manager's job. And then you repeat, iterate. And you see what it is. It's a sprint, right? I never told them that. So you can work with performance management just like you perform a sprint. It's exactly how you can adapt the way you work. Agile performance trends, of course, continuous goal setting, continuous coaching, continuous feedback. Instead of doing it around the year, you do it once a month, once every 2 weeks. I mean, it's very good to do performance related to the sprint. So you do the planning. If you have 2 week sprints, then you do the performance in equal intervals, so to speak. Happiness index. You should measure often, not once a year. And then you can see the trends. And there are very easy ways. 3 questions. How happy are you? What would make you even more happy? And how can I, as a manager, facilitate for you to be happy? Recruit. Trends within recruitment. It's from only evaluating competence to also evaluate behavior, or maybe more behavior, because then you will thrive in the organization if you have the same values and a behavior that works in the organization. From just HR working with recruitment to working in cross-functional teams with marketing and managers, of course, as well. And some other trends. We don't have time. This is a Kanban. It's from Spotify. It's also a Swedish company. They work with the Kanban when they to their recruitment to visualize the work. Development, we have talked about that. T-shaped competence, we want T-shaped people who have a specialized area, but also a broad general area, and then we can get very flexible teams. We can take on different roles. they can exchange roles and they can learn from each other. And then we increase flexibility in our organizations. Development, develop all the time, lunch and learn. Always try to build new learnings into every day. And we learn best in small chunks, not big, like 2-day courses and so on. Reward, salary is a hygiene factor. It's not something that makes people go to work every day. Everybody should give recognition. From very seldom to often, we should reward often. From big rewards to smaller rewards. From reward privately, only the manager and employee knows, to rewarding publicly. And reward results goes away. Instead, we want to reward behavior as well. Scrum for HR, does it work? Yes, of course it works. There are two different angles to Scrum for HR. The HR team themselves can work like a Scrum team, right? Exactly the same way. But also the products that HR deliver to the business should be agile. They should breathe the agile values. Yep. Start as simple as possible, but not simpler. And you don't build a business, you build people. I'm finalizing with, I would like to welcome you to Stockholm on September 25. We have a conference called Agile People Sweden, which is a conference not for IT mainly, but there is all the IT people coming as well, of course, because it's about Agile. But it's about Agile HR, Agile leadership, and Agile for the bigger organizations. So welcome to Stockholm. If you have the way past Sweden in September, maybe. Questions?
Don't think we have time for questions because we've already gone over. But it is a break time now, so if you guys do want to catch Pia-Maria during the break, then please come up and do so.
Thank you.